Long before there were movie stars or rock stars, one man was a true international superstar. His name was John Rarey, and he tamed horses. Not just any horses, but the most dangerous, vicious horses that could be found. He did it with kindness, patience, and firmness, and he became known throughout the world. John Solomon Rarey was born December 6, 1827, just outside Columbus, Ohio, in what is now the town of Groveport. He was the 11th child of Adam and Mary Catherine Rarey. The couple farmed a large piece of land and operated a roadside inn. The inn was a popular rest stop for travelers on the way to Columbus and a favorite place for local farmers and townspeople to socialize. There were always plenty of interesting people and horses coming and going. From childhood, John Rarey had a fascination with horses, and he seemed to have a natural ability to calm them down. One day he was riding his pony when it suddenly spooked and began running headlong through the streets of town, jumping ditches, crashing through trees, across fields, through water, raising a real ruckus. Well, John Rarey stayed on the horse, finally got it stopped, and then rode it calmly back home. This incident was the talk of the town because John Rarey was only 9 years old at the time. Being good with horses was an important skill back then. 170 years ago, when John Rarey was a boy, horses were vital to everyday life. Everyone needed hardworking, dependable, and safe horses. And it didn't matter whether you were a farmer working the fields, a businessman in the city, or a lady out for a Sunday drive. By the age of 12, John Rarey was a professional horse trainer, being paid by neighbors to work with their horses. As he grew, he learned more and more about how horses think. He also learned how to read and write, something that 4 out of 5 Americans at the time couldn't do. In his early 20s, John Rarey went to Kentucky to study with an older horseman, the famous Denton Offutt. Now, history is all but forgotten, Offutt the horseman. But he is remembered as the merchant who gave young Abe Lincoln his start in business many years earlier. By 1856, John Rarey had published his first book, The Modern Art of Taming Wild Horses. He was also traveling extensively, and everywhere he went, he would prove that his method worked and actively solicit students. Now, Rarey's plan was to sell his horse taming secret through subscription classes and his book. In the early days, he made his students promise not to reveal what he'd taught them or show anybody the book. But in just a few years, he would become so successful that he would publicly release all of his students from this pledge. Rarey's big break came in 1858 at the age of 30, when he was invited to England to demonstrate his gentling methods to the British Army. That led to a command performance for Queen Victoria and Prince Albert, first at Windsor Castle, and then again in the riding school at Buckingham Palace. It also led to his greatest challenge, taming a horse belonging in part to Guy Carleton, the Earl of Dorchester. The horse was a large 6-year-old bay thoroughbred stallion named Cruiser. Cruiser was bred for racing, and at one time he'd been considered the fastest horse in England. But he was just too volatile for a career on the track. According to Lord Dorchester,
"He was vicious from a foal, troublesome to handle, and showed his temper at any opportunity."
During these temper tantrums, Cruiser could be very destructive, so he was kept in a brick stall, heavily muzzled and strapped, for 2 years. His keepers were considering blinding him to make him easier to handle. Cruiser came to Rarey's attention as the result of a dare, a challenge issued by a London sports writer named Argus, who wrote in the Morning Post on March 2, 1858,
"If Mr. Rarey can ride Cruiser as a hack, I would guarantee him immortality and an amount of ready money that would make a British bank director's mouth water."
By this time, Rarey had built quite a reputation among English horsemen, but he also had his detractors. Some said he used secret potions or hypnotism, or that he had never faced a really difficult horse. So Rarey took up this dare as a way to silence his critics.
Rarey went to see Cruiser, and what he found surprised him.
Rarey found that Cruiser was as angry and vicious as he was rumored to be, but he was in poor condition. He had a wound inside of his knee, bruises on his side, and the muzzle had nearly worn a hole in his head. So Rarey decided to wait until he healed, until he tried anything.
Before he even got back to London, newspapers were already claiming that Rarey had visited Cruiser and was afraid to touch him. A few weeks later, Argus repeated his challenge in the morning newspaper, and that was the final straw. Rarey set out immediately for Lord Dorchester's country home.
Rarey walked into the stall, stood perfectly still, and showed no fear whatsoever. I think curiosity was Cruiser's reaction, because he came right up to him and even let Rarey stroke him. But then, a sudden sound scared Cruiser, and he charged. Rarey dodged him, but Lord Dorchester, fearful for Rarey's safety, urged him to tie his head. Against his better judgment, Rarey did. The restraint made Cruiser furious, and he fought so hard that Rarey thought he was going to kill himself or smash the building down. He untied him and started over. It took 3 hours and Rarey's best skill, but by midday, Rarey was riding him around the estate. He invited Lord Dorchester to do so too, and he tried it without any trouble.
A week later, Rarey presented Cruiser to the public in what the London press dubbed Mr. Rarey's Cruiser Soiree. More demonstrations followed, and the Queen and royal children became frequent visitors, lavishing affection on a horse that, until recently, had been feared and hated by everyone. The Earl of Dorchester was so moved, he gave his interest in Cruiser to Rarey. Rarey purchased the remaining shares. And for the better part of the next decade, man and horse traveled the world together. Rarey would lecture and present Cruiser, then take on the toughest local horses that could be found. There were biters and strikers, kickers, rearers, and screamers. But Rarey's recipe of kindness, patience, and firmness always came through. And the legend grew. But what exactly did Rarey do that took the wild out of these horses? Well, first you have to understand the three fundamental principles of Rarey's theory, founded on the leading characteristics of the horse. First, that he is so constituted by nature that he will not offer resistance to any demand made of him, which he fully comprehends, if made in a way consistent with the laws of his nature. Second, that he has no consciousness of his strength beyond his experience, and can be handled according to our will without force. Third, that we can, in compliance with the laws of his nature by which he examines all things new to him, take any object, however frightful, around, over, or on him that does not inflict pain without causing him to fear. Rarey put these principles to work in a taming method that centered on a simple and ancient concept. Control a horse's movement, and you'll control his mind. Controlling movement can be done in three ways. We can cause movement, as in driving a horse away in a round pen. We can change the direction or speed of movement, which is a key part of many groundwork exercises. Or we can inhibit movement. Now, this is the most difficult and dangerous way to control movement because in the horse's mind, giving up the ability to run away only happens if he's about to die, and he doesn't want to die. Rarey's way of inhibiting a horse's movement was to lay him down. Rarey began with a one-leg hobble, a soft leather strap that he used to hold the horse's left front leg in a flexed position. After hobbling the front leg, Rarey would apply two additional straps, a surcingle around the belly, and a fetlock strap looped around the remaining foreleg. The free end of the fetlock strap would pass through the surcingle. Getting the straps in place was really the toughest part, and in the case of Cruiser, it took some extra ingenuity. But once Rarey had done that, the horse was his, because what followed always worked. Standing on the horse's left side, Rarey took hold of the bridle with his left hand and the strap attached to the front leg with his right hand. Then he pulled the horse's head toward him and pushed the body away with his shoulder, putting the horse off balance and causing it to take a hopping step with its one good leg. At that moment, Rarey pulled on the fetlock strap and brought the horse to its knees in one smooth motion. Now, this was a tense moment. The horse could rear up and fight going down. If so, Rarey maintained his composure, kept the fetlock strap pulled taut, and stayed with the horse until it chose to lie down on its side, tired and frightened, but calm. Once the horse was lying on the ground, Rarey removed the hobble and straps, straightened the horse's legs, and began rubbing and comforting it. Then he urged the horse to its feet. The procedure was often repeated several times. Each time, the horse became calmer and more bonded with the man. You may wonder why the simple act of lying down has such a profound effect on a horse's attitude. Well, first of all, it's not just lying down. It's lying down against the horse's will in the presence of a predator. Now, the horse knows that flat on his side, he has no defenses whatsoever. He's completely vulnerable. That's a very humbling experience. In the horse's mind, he's coming face to face with death, and that would change any creature. Rarey's method earned the horse's respect and trust, and it literally made the Rarey name a household word in the 1860s. Samuel Johnson's Dictionary of the English Language added the verb rarefy, which meant, quote, to tame a horse by kindness, to win by love, to mollify by the oil of kindness, to reclaim a badly broken horse, to cure madness by excessive kindness, end quote. Ohio's capital city is a busy, modern place today, but a few minutes' drive from the airport, you can step back into Rarey's world. Here at the Ohio Historical Society Museum in Columbus, the famous Minor Kellogg oil painting of John Rarey and Cruiser is on permanent display. And carefully packed away are Cruiser's muzzle, 8 pounds of iron and leather that kept him from killing his keepers, a thick hardwood gag bit that Cruiser wore when not in the muzzle, a purple tasseled and bejeweled headdress that the reformed Cruiser sometimes wore on stage, and mementos Rarey collected in his world travels. And at the Groveport Heritage Museum, you begin to get a sense of who John Rarey really was, including the way he was portrayed in newspapers. Rarey's work was a dramatic and effective departure from the norm, and it thoroughly captivated the public's imagination. Even during America's Civil War, the quiet Ohio horse tamer was big news. And in Groveport, he still is. His story is told on plaques and markers all around town, and the local high school calls its sports teams the Cruisers. The school sits on land that was once the Rarey farm. It's believed that Cruiser was buried somewhere on these grounds after his death in 1875. John Solomon Rarey died in 1866 at the age of just 38 following a stroke. He had achieved fame and fortune, and for decades horsemen emulated him, yet he would remain the standard by which all horse tamers were judged into the 20th century. Today, in most parts of the world, John Rarey and Cruiser have been long forgotten, but their spirit lives on here in Groveport and in the heart of every horseman who tries to see the world through the horse's eyes.